sang this morning, please? I thought it was Team A that's going to sing. Isn't that what I said? Do you want me to call your names? You've forgotten who you are? Well, we'll take whatever. Whoever wants to help sing, please, we need some help. Come on up here and help us. Doesn't matter what team you're on. Just so you're on God's team. Okay, we're going to sing Cleanse Me or Search Me. It's known by both names. The words are so fitting for our lesson. Thank you, Kalita. let's stand and sing. And, okay, just pay attention to the words. Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray. I'm going to pick up the tempo a little bit because that takes all the breath I've got to hold that out like that. Okay, here we go again. I praise thee, Lord, for cleansing me from sin. That was your prayer this morning. Viola, would you lead us in prayer, please? team. Will you open your Bibles, please, to Romans chapter 7? Now, you remember in Romans 6 that Paul explained that Christ has freed us from sin's penalty, and the Holy Spirit frees us from sin's power. Now, in chapter 7, he explains that believers are also free from the law. And Paul uses the word law 23 times in this chapter. Now, what is your first reaction when someone tells you you can't do something? You want to do it, don't you? You know, it's like telling a four-year-old not to poke beans up his nose. He might not have thought to do that, but now that you've told him don't do that, he wants to do it. And when you see a sign that says, keep out, you want to go in. If the speed limit is 35 miles per hour, you want to drive 45. Now, I read a true story that in Galveston, Texas, a hotel on the shore of the Gulf of Mexico was having trouble with people fishing from the balconies. And the lead weights on the fishing lines were hitting the glass windows on the floors below and cracking them. So the manager put a notice in each room that said, no fishing from the balcony. Yet every day, hotel guests threw in their lines to the waters below. And then the management decided to take down the signs. And lo and behold, the fishing stopped. You see, laws have a way of stirring up rebellion in us. We have a natural tendency to desire the forbidden thing. We dislike being told what to do and what not to do. Give us a law and we will see it as a challenge to break it. That's one of the traits of Adam's old sin nature that's still inside us. We were not made to know and love laws. We were made to know and love God. Now, you want your child to obey you, but you also want his love and affection. And God does not want from us a mechanical obedience to certain rules. He wants our love and our loyalty, and if we love him, we will obey him. But we tend to get the idea that all God wants is obedience. So we work hard and stay busy trying to earn his approval. Now, legalism is the belief that we can earn our way to God or please him by keeping a set of rules. Legalism measures spirituality by a list of do's and don'ts. It judges by outward actions and not inward motives. And legalism sets high standards, and when they're not reached, the person gets discouraged and frustrated and just gives up trying to live a godly life. Now, Paul wanted the Roman believers to understand that they could not be saved by trying to keep the law, nor could they be sanctified by trying to keep the law. It is only when we stop trying to perform for God and just yield to the power available to us in Christ Jesus that we can become holy. Now, you remember in chapter 6 that Paul used the illustration of a master and servant to explain how the Christian should yield himself to God. But in verses 1 to 6 of chapter 7, he used the illustration of a husband and wife to show that the believer has a new relationship to the law because of his union with Jesus Christ. Now, when a man and woman marry, they're united for life. But if the husband dies, the wife is free to remarry because she is no longer bound to him in marriage. Death has broken the marriage relationship and set her free. Now, before we were saved, we were married to the law. But when we placed our faith and trust in Christ Jesus, we died with him and we were freed from our marriage to the law. Now, when Christ arose, we arose with him into a new life. We were united with him as our new husband. And since we have died to the law, we're free from the law. The law has no authority over a dead person. Now, to illustrate the point that Paul is making, J. Vernon McGee told the story of a plantation owner back in the antebellum days before the Civil War. When the man took sick and died suddenly, his wife was heartbroken, and she did a strange and morbid thing. She had his body embalmed and placed in a sitting position in a chair in an airtight glass case. And she situated it in the great hallway of her lovely southern home. And the minute you opened the front door, you were looking at him. Well, her friends realized that this was not going to do. So they urged her to get away for a while. And she traveled abroad for almost 2 years. And during that time, she met and fell in love with another man and married him. And after their honeymoon, they returned to her plantation home, and the new bridegroom picked her up and carried her over the threshold. And when he put her down, he was staring into the face of a man in a glass case. And he said, "Who is that?" And the new bride had forgotten about her dead husband. And when she told him who it was, they decided it was time to bury him. She was married to a new man. The old man was dead. And that story illustrates how the believer who is no longer bound to the law is free to serve our new husband, Jesus Christ. Now, when we were married to the law, there was no power inside us to help us obey the law. In fact, the more we tried, the more we failed. The fruit of our union with the law was death. But now that we are married to Christ, we have his spirit inside us to empower us to serve him and to bear eternal fruit for God. In John 15:5, Jesus said, "Apart from me, you can do nothing. But with him, we can do everything he asks us to do." And Philippians 4:13 reminds us that we can do everything through him who gives us strength. There's a little verse that says, "I do not work my soul to save. That work my Lord has done. But I will work like any slave for love of God's dear Son." Now let's look at verses 7 to 13 where we see the purpose of the law. Now Paul doesn't want you to get the idea that the law is not good or that we don't need it anymore. The real problem is sin, not the law. You know, an x-ray may reveal a serious break in your leg, but do you blame the x-ray for the break? A thermometer may show you that you have a fever of 105 degrees. But do you get angry and break the thermometer? Would you blame the doctor for informing you of a life-threatening disease? Of course you wouldn't. And when we have trouble keeping the law of God, the problem is not with the law. The problem is with the sin nature in our hearts. Now, the law was not the cause of the act of sin. The sin nature in the heart of man is the cause, and sin brings spiritual death. You know, a speed limit sign may stir up our rebellious nature to break that law and to speed, and the result may be death. But the law against speeding didn't cause death. It was the sin of breaking that law that caused it. Now, the law was designed by God to diagnose man's sinful condition, to make us aware that we're sinners in need of a Savior. The law is holy and just and good, but we can never be made holy by the law because its purpose is not to remove sin, but to reveal sin. And we would not have recognized our sin if the law hadn't spelled it out for us. You see, the law wakes us up to an awareness of sin. The sin was there all the time, but the law just pointed it out to us. And once we become aware of our sin, we are without excuse, and we stand condemned before God. You remember in the Gospel of Mark, the rich young man is a good example of the use of the law to point out sin and show a man his need for a Savior. Now, this man was very moral outwardly. He had never murdered anyone. He had never committed adultery. He had never robbed anyone or given false witness or dishonored his parents. But he had never faced the sins within his heart. And when Jesus told him to sell everything he had and give it to the poor, the man went away in great sorrow because he had great wealth. You see, the commandment, thou shalt not covet, revealed to him the sin of covetousness and showed him what a sinner he really was. But instead of admitting his sin and repenting of it, he rejected Christ and went away unsaved, still dead in his sins. Now, not only does knowledge of the law reveal sin, the law is powerless to prevent sin. The law cannot change anyone. Jesus called the Word of God a mirror. It shows us what we are. Now, if you have a spot on your face, the mirror will show it to you, but it can't remove the spot. And God's law will show you the spots, but it cannot remove them. Only the blood of Jesus can cleanse us of sin. In leaders' meeting last week, Viola said that the blood of Jesus is the best stain remover there is. Now, there are three things the law cannot do. First, the law cannot change you. It cannot transform the old sin nature. It can only reveal how sinful that old nature is. Second, the law cannot enable you to do good. You see, left to himself, man cannot obey God's law because the old nature rebels against the law. Now, the new self may delight in the law of God, but the old self delights in breaking the law of God. And then third, the law cannot set you free. The true Christian does not want to sin. We want to be free from sin. And we determine that we will not sin, and we do the best we can, but it's still not good enough. Now let's look at verses 14 to 25, where we see the struggle with the law. Remember last week I told you that I was shocked to learn that I could sin after I became a Christian at the age of 10? The sad fact is that becoming a Christian does not immunize us from sin. Even the great Apostle Paul struggled with sinful desires. And in these verses, Paul opens his heart and shares with us an account of his own spiritual struggles. And notice he uses the first person pronouns I, my, and myself. They're used 47 times in this section. Someone said that the biggest trouble with sin is the I in the middle of it. Now, there are two opposing principles at work in every Christian: the power of indwelling sin and the power of the indwelling spirit. Now, the Living Bible expresses this conflict so well that I would like to read it to you from the Living Bible. And notice that there are two I's in these verses. One is the new nature and one is the old nature. And Paul says, I don't understand myself at all, for I, he's talking about the new nature, really want to do what is right, but I, the old nature, can't. I do what I don't want to, what I hate. I know perfectly well that what I am doing is wrong, and that the laws I am breaking are good ones. But I can't help myself because I'm not doing it. It is sin inside me that is stronger than I am that makes me do these evil things. I know I am rotten through and through, so far as my old sinful nature is concerned. And by the way, Jeremiah agrees with Paul, because in Jeremiah 17:9, he said, "The heart is deceitful or wicked above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it?" And then Paul goes on to say, "No matter which way I turn, I cannot make myself do right. I want to, but I can't. When I want to do good, I don't. And when I try not to do wrong, I do it anyway. Now, if I am doing what I don't want to do, it is plain where the trouble is. Sin still has me in its evil grasp. It seems to be a fact of life that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love to do God's will so far as my new nature is concerned, but there's something else deep within me, in my lower nature, that is at war with my mind and wins the fight and makes me a slave to the sin and death that are still within me. In my mind, I want to be God's willing servant, but instead I find myself still enslaved to sin." That's the great Paul. In Matthew 26:41, Jesus said, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." But then Paul went on to say, "So you see how it is. My new life tells me to do right, but the old nature that is still inside me loves to sin." And the New International Version says, "What a wretched man I am." And wretched comes from the word that means to be exhausted from fighting in a battle. Paul was worn out from fighting the war going on inside him. Does that sound familiar? You know, I may start the day with Bible reading and prayer, determined that today I'm going to live for Christ. But in no time at all, somebody rubs me the wrong way, or the car won't start, or a telemarketer calls, and I react in a way that I know I shouldn't. And then I feel terrible, and I run to God and confess it and start all over again. Things go along pretty good for about an hour, and then I mess up again, and so on and so on. That reminds me of the cartoon that you've probably seen of the person who prays, "Dear Lord, so far today I've done all right. I haven't gossiped, I haven't lost my temper, I haven't been greedy or grumpy or grouchy, but in a few minutes, Lord, I'm going to get out of bed. And from then on, I'm going to need your help." Now, you may ask the question, well, if I'm a Christian, why can't I lick the old sin nature? Well, there's something you and I need to understand. Before we were saved, we had just one nature, the old man or the old self, which we inherited from Adam. And when we were born again, we received a new spiritual nature imparted to us by God. And when we received our new nature, we began to love the things we used to hate and hate the things we used to love. We had new desires and new goals, but the old nature wasn't done away with. For years, the old nature had complete control of our bodies, using them as instruments of unrighteousness, and it doesn't want to lose that control. So when the new nature wants to use our bodies as instruments of righteousness, there's a conflict. There is no peaceful coexistence. You see, the believer is a walking civil war. Now, you may have heard the story about a man who owned two dogs. It's an old story, but I like it. It's a good illustration. He had a black dog and a white dog, and they were always fighting with each other. And he was asked which dog usually wins, and he said, "The one I feed the most." And ladies, we've got two dogs inside us. If we feed the black dog the scraps of the old nature, he's going to overpower the white dog. But if we feed the new nature with the word of God and prayer and fellowship with other believers and surrender to the control of the Holy Spirit, the white dog will overpower the black dog. He won't kill him, but he can cripple him and make him so sore he won't want to fight for a while. Now, everywhere you go, you have these two dogs with you. If you take that black dog where you are easily tempted, you're going to have a big fight on your hands. But if you take that white dog to places that would help you grow and mature spiritually, that old black dog has to tuck his tail between his legs and slink off into a corner. So you have a choice as to who you're going to feed and let gain the upper hand. Now keep in mind that Paul is writing of his personal experiences as a believer, and he is writing to believers. These verses do not refer to an unsaved person. A lost person does not have a deep desire to obey and serve God. The fact that we long to do what is right and that we detest the evil that we do is one of the surest indications that we're saved. The more we mature spiritually, the more we are grieved by our sin. Now, here's how to tell the difference between a pig and a prodigal, between an unbeliever and a believer who is struggling with sin. If you take the pig out of the pig pen and wash him in a bubble bath and spray him with cologne and put a ribbon around his neck and tie a bow on his tail and then turn him loose, watch what happens the first time he sees a mud puddle. The pig will run to it and wallow in it because he's a pig. But the prodigal, although he might find himself in the mud at times, he's not going to be comfortable in it. He's not going to want to stay there. Eventually, he'll come to his senses and decide, I want out of here. I hate this stuff. Now, most unsaved people judge Christians who are struggling with sin and call them hypocrites. But a hypocrite is a person who pretends to be something he is not. A believer who is very aware of the sin in his life and trying to overcome it is not a hypocrite. In fact, the struggle with sin is evidence that God is at work in our lives to conform us to the image of his Son. Dennis DeHaan, who writes for Our Daily Bread, wrote this little verse. Struggle, yes, it's part of living. Nothing's gained on beds of ease. When our heart is set on Jesus, struggle drives us to our knees. You see, a dead person doesn't struggle. He's already dead in his sin. A saved person constantly struggles to overcome sin, and he will until he is freed from this body of sin and goes to be with the Lord. Now, in the last part of verse 24, Paul asked, who will deliver me from this body of death? Now, centuries ago, some Roman emperors were known to inflict the hideous punishment of binding the corpse of a murder victim to the back of the murderer. And under penalty of death, no one was allowed to remove that dead body from the condemned person. And this gruesome practice calls to mind the words of Paul. It's as if a dead body were strapped to him and accompanied him wherever he went. And Paul was expressing the experience of every child of God. At times, we feel helplessly bound to the dead body of our sinful nature. And the tendency to sin is always with us. So who will deliver us from this body of death? Well, in verse 25, Paul says, I thank God there is someone who will deliver me, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Paul goes from depression to deliverance. Now, because the believer is united to Christ, he is dead to the law and no longer under its authority. The law gave us no power to obey, but in Christ, we have the power of the Holy Spirit to enable us to live the Christian life. Now, when God saved us, he did not leave us to go fend for ourselves in this evil world. He put his spirit inside us, and he will never leave us or forsake us. He's there to convict us of sin and to correct us and guide us and comfort us and conform us to the image of Christ. Now, I wish that God had seen fit to vaccinate us against sin the moment we were saved, but he didn't do that. Instead, he gave us his indwelling spirit to empower us to resist evil. We cannot live the Christian life in our own energy or strength or wisdom. We're utterly dependent on Christ in us. The secret of doing good is to yield to the control of the Holy Spirit. Philippians 2:13 tells us that it is God who works in you to will and act according to his good purpose. If Jesus lives within you, sin need not overwhelm you. 1 John 4:4 reminds us that the one who is in you, the Holy Spirit, is greater than the one who is in the world. That's Satan. The question is, will you give God total control of your life? You see, under his control, you can have victory over sin and self and Satan. God wants us to be victors, not victims. He wants us to soar, not sink. He wants us to overcome, not be overwhelmed. Now, next week in chapter 8, Paul is going to explain how the Holy Spirit works to overcome the bad and produce the good. But ladies, there is victory in Jesus. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you that when you saved us, that you indwelt us by your Holy Spirit, who has the power to enable us to live for you. Oh, Father, we are so grateful that your Spirit will never leave us or forsake us. Lord, I pray for these ladies today. I thank you for their sweet presence, for their dedication to come, and their hunger and thirst for your word. But Lord, as we sang that blessed hymn today, search my heart, Lord. Cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Fill me with your Spirit and empower me to live for you and to be a light in this dark world. Give us boldness and courage to speak up, to speak out, and to live out your word before a lost world. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.